this is called a circle of confidence. And what happens is when we meet the most inspiring women and we just want to hear about their story and their journey, it's entree new. It's like this. This is a circle of confidence. It's a confidence circle where anything goes in here and we tell it like it is. We do tell it like it is even in lounges, even when we have power conversations, but this is a one-on-one, and you know, we want to bring visibility to people making a difference, but our people happen to be women making a difference. And one of the biggest problems we have in this industry is visibility of women doing remarkable things. Women in the past, historically, we've been written out of history. Women today, sometimes we just, our stories don't get shared of how impactful we are. And of course, inspiring the next generation. So we do a lot of mentorship in the moment with the next generation. I mean, how do we expect that next generation to lead if we are not, you know, sharing our journey and our stories with them and inspiring them to take that leadership role and then twist it up with their own personality? So I'm so excited to have this circle of confidence with Nancy. And so for anyone that doesn't know Nancy Hill, Nancy is the CEO of the 4A's. And is now leaving the 4A's after how many years?
9.5.
After 9.5 years to move on to her next chapter. She is not retiring. She is bolder, braver, and badasser, if badasser is a word, badasser than ever before. And that's Nancy Hill. So I'm so thrilled to have this conversation with you.
Well, thank you.
It is your last 4A's as leading this organization, but I think it is the first page in your next chapter.
It is, I hope, yes.
Yeah, so, I mean, when we talk about legacy, you know, we all hope that we're gonna leave a legacy. And very recently, I had a window, 200-pound window, fly off a wall and pin me on the ground. And I had those couple of moments of, one, I hope my children will be taken care of. Two, I hope that I'm leaving a legacy at this stage of my life that I can be proud of. Three, you know, we all need to live the life that we want to live. And four, I hope there's guardian angels from, you know, having this window crush my body. And so I believe in legacy, and I believe in doing work that we're proud of. Tell me, what is your most proud moment for what you've done for the 4A's?
Well, I think anybody who knows anything about our organization would say that prior to me coming on board, we didn't talk about diversity and equality. Just, you know, if we don't talk about it, it doesn't really happen. And misogyny and sexism and racism and all of those other isms in our industry just didn't get talked about. And I decided very early on that I was not going to allow that to happen, and that especially as a woman at the head of the trade association, that that was going to be something that I was going to tackle and I was going to put front and center, and we were going to have those conversations. And just to give you a context, the organization is 100 years old and I'm the 9th person in this role. I'm the first woman in this role. It had been a large parade. Even our chairman, with the exception of two women over the course of the 100-year history, Charlotte Beers and Shelley Lazarus, otherwise it was all white men. And that outside of our old boardroom was a long wall, and they had pictures of all of the past CEOs and the past chairman on that wall. So here's this large wall of about 50 people with two women, and actually more like 60 people with two women. And we run a multicultural advertising internship program every summer for 100, 150. This year it's 200 kids. And these are all non-white kids coming in to start their future in advertising. And here's what success looks like. Yeah, exactly. And I said, okay, so that's coming down. So as soon as my predecessor's picture got up, it all came down. And that was the tone I wanted to set right from the beginning, that this was not going to be something we didn't talk about. It was going to be something that we did talk about, and we were going to address it head on. The second thing that I did was that I made the way that we went about hiring very intentional. And so if you've ever come into our offices, and I've had people say this to me, it looks like the UN our staff, because we are, I don't know the exact numbers, but I would say that we're probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 35 or 40% non-white. We're at least 50% women, if not more than that. And we try to be really intentional about the way that we go about hiring to make sure that we do that, because I feel like we have to model it in order to ask people to live up to that kind of a standard. And then, you know,
before you go on, I want to ask you a question. Diversity is a choice, so I applaud you for that, and we're going to go back to that. But what is the ratio of diversity in the ad agency business?
So I wish I knew the real answer to that question, but the reality is that the agencies have been very reluctant to give us those specific numbers. They will give you overall numbers, but that doesn't really tell a true story, because when you start looking at overall numbers, the overall number might look pretty good. It might look like it's 50% women or 60% women, but then you start picking that apart and what you realize is that it's the receptionist and the administrative people, and it's not really the executives or the creative, especially the creative department, which is a whole conference in and of itself. So trying to get at some of the nuances of what the real numbers mean with regard to both gender and ethnic diversity and LGBTQ and anything that is non-white straight male is almost impossible.
Okay. So I just wanted to know if it was a
representation. I'd say we're much higher, and I know that mostly from anecdotal information, but I just know also from what I see.
Out of 800
exactly,
people,
yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
It's predominantly.
Although it's better, I would say it's better this year than it has been in many years, so I'm happy about that. And that brings up the third thing that we've done, which is we've gotten incredibly intentional about our speaker lineups for every conference. I demand from the people on our staff who program these conferences that they shoot for at least 50% gender equality, and that they be very mindful about ethnic diversity as well as they're programming this. And so I know for a fact at this conference we've overshot on the 50% in some sessions more so than others. There's some places, programmatic being one of them, where you just, it's all men, and that's who's involved in those desks, and so it makes it very difficult. But we work really hard to make those numbers work, and I, you know, when people come to me and say, I'm trying, it's like, then you're not looking in the right place until you get it right. So we've made that another intent. So I'd say for me, my legacy is that I have forced this issue, and I've not been quiet about it, and I've not let anybody get away with the usual bullshit of I can't find somebody. Whether that's hiring somebody, putting somebody on a stage, I don't care. I once had a creative director who had just taken, or a CCO, so a chief creative officer, who had just taken a role at one of the major multinational agencies, so he's worldwide chief creative officer. And 6 months in, he's made some pretty big hires, and they were all men. And I said to him, I don't understand. He said, well, Nancy, I just can't find him. And I said, that's bullshit, and that's a lazy excuse, and I don't accept it. And, you know, he came to me about a year later, and he since then hired quite a few women. He said, I heard you. And I think that's the thing, is that, and, you know, I do my thing in my own way, and Cindy does her thing in her own way, and you do your thing in your own way, but we each are coming at it from the same, you know, let's solve this problem, and I'm not going to let you off the hook that easily.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the things that I've been well known for is, you know, of course I've been a CEO, a chief executive officer, but I'm well known to be a chief troublemaker, mainly because doing it my way, doing it your way, is not the normal way or the standard way. And if we don't keep pushing, the new way won't become the new norm.
That's right.
And so I think I want to go back to, you know, you bringing diversity and equality and inclusivity front and center. How was that received? I mean, did people say, oh yeah, Nancy, we agree? Or was there pushback? Or
well, you know, you have to think about the timing. So I started at the 4A's in 2008, and at that moment in time, besides the Great Recession, which was, oh, congratulations, you're president of the 4A's, and oh, by the way, the agencies can't pay you anymore. That aside, the other thing that was happening was the New York City Commission on Human Rights was threatening all the agencies and making them report their numbers. Again, still broader numbers than I would like to see. And there was the threat of a major class action lawsuit with Cyrus Mayrie. And so the agencies were under incredible outside pressure on the overall diversity front, which by the way included gender as part of that. And so at the time, it kind of gave me this perfect opportunity to be vocal about it because nobody was going to shut me down. And so I saw that opportunity and I said, okay, I'm making this my platform. I'm going to take the bull by the horn. I'm going to go. I went and spoke to the New York City Council on Human Rights. I sat down with Cyrus Mayrie. I sat down with Jesse Jackson. I sat down with Al Sharpton. I sat down at all of those people who were coming after us on any number of fronts and said, talk to me, tell me what we can do. And rather than just hiding because I might say the wrong thing, I said, we're gonna go after this. The interesting thing was the staff took a year or two to catch up to me in terms of understanding that I was serious about things like 50% on stage. They thought, yeah, we'll try. No, I'm serious about this. And if you don't achieve that goal, it's going to hurt you in the long run.
So you created accountability
for
that.
Yeah.
Which is a big missing piece is the accountability. First of all, I won't touch you. Jesse Jackson, and Al Sharpton. But tell everybody what the class action suit with Cyrus was.
So the class action suit that was being threatened was... Cyrus Mayrie is a well-known class action civil rights lawyer who's gone after the two of note that he went after. One was Wall Street on behalf of women, and the other was the NFL on behalf of African-American coaches, and in both cases he won those lawsuits. The difference in terms of going after the NFL teams and the Wall Street firms and going after the agencies is this, and I'm not saying that there aren't issues, there are, but my job in sitting where I was to talk to him about the reality of what he was trying to do. With the holding companies being holding companies, they're not employers, and most people don't understand that. The employers are BBDO and McCann and the agencies
that make up the holding
exactly.
company.
They're the ones, that's who's the paycheck you get a paycheck from. You don't get a paycheck from Omnicom. And so the reality is that putting together a class to go after an employer, when that employer in this instance, let's just follow that through with BBDO, has no money. The money's up here. The money's not down here. So you can't really put together a class action lawsuit. I'm not saying they were wrong in terms of, yes, there's a problem, but my job where I sit was to make sure that that went away. And it eventually did go away because I sat down with him in painstaking detail and walked him through why this was never gonna work. The other issue was that he couldn't put together a class because there were too many spread out across too many agencies. Mm-hmm. So you don't have a class of 50 going against one agency, you have a class of 50 going against an industry, and that's not ever going to work. That all said, one of the things that moment in time allowed was lots of conversations about what can we do to change this, and it gave me, as I said, that opportunity to be pretty vocal, and nobody was pushing back at that moment in time.
It's really amazing. By the way, women's soccer just won the case that men and women soccer players are paid the same. So today on Equal Pay Day, I mean, it didn't happen today. It happened, I think, last week or something.
That was hockey, wasn't it?
Was it hockey? No, I thought it was soccer.
But soccer was a while ago. This was another team.
Was it hockey?
Does anybody know what really happened?
I thought it was soccer.
I think it was hockey. Soccer won a while ago.
Soccer won a while ago. Okay, so it was hockey now, just a week ago or 2 days. I don't know. The days turn into...
It's the second one, though. And that's the important part of the equation.
Right.
So they're all starting to fall, and they all will fall. And the thing is that women have to keep pushing, because if we don't push, it's not going to happen.
Right, but also, it's not our issue. You know, I say gender equality is not a female issue. It is a social and economic issue. And yes, we have to push because men are not feeling the issues, so it's not a priority for them. But once we identify the problem, we do need, you know, leaders, male or female, to change the game.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think that one of the things that I've noticed, just even in the last, I'll say, so I've been involved with this by the way, since way before I came to the 4A's, I was always the only woman at the top of an agency, which made me in charge of diversity.
Exactly. It's woman, usually an African-American woman, though.
That's well, there wasn't one, so there was me,
right.
Which put me in charge of diversity. And so I've been involved in the overall issue for a long time. And I will tell you that what I see now, and it was interesting because at one moment in time, I was presenting the first ever worldwide survey of all of our employees. So we had done a cut on Black, Hispanic, self-identified LGBT, and women, and I intentionally saved the research on the women to last because I was presenting it. And so I took the, and it was all men I was presenting
to. So it didn't seem self-serving.
Exactly. Okay. And there's another reason, and I suspected something was gonna happen, and it did, and I'll get to that in a second. So I took them through, here's a survey on how Black people feel, here's the survey on how Hispanics feel, LGBT, and they're sitting there just nodding their heads and looking at me like, yeah, okay, I get that. Oh, that's really interesting. Never thought about that. You know, mental note, so on and so on. And then I get to the presentation on women. The rolling eyes and the, oh my God, how can they feel that way, that came out of their mouths was such a stark difference between this group, this group, this group, because in their mind, they've been working with women for 30, 40, 50 years. They never knew that women felt this way before. How could they feel this way? Why hasn't anybody told me? And of course, as a woman, I'm standing up there and I'm trying to, and then they'd say, they don't really feel that way. Yeah, they do. I'll tell you, they do. I know this for a fact. It was just so fascinating to watch them say, yeah. But they think they know because they've been working with us for so long that they know how we feel or how we think, but we haven't spoken up. And so now we're speaking up. And the reason I tell you that whole long story is that I see a lot less eye rolling now than I used to see. And that gives me hope.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, one of the things I say is leadership today needs to have feminine qualities, which is compassion,
yes,
responsiveness, listening, you know, nurturing, empathy. And I think that that's what we're starting to identify, is finding those leaders to lead with compassion and responsive leadership, and it's inspiring the others to follow suit.
I agree.
That we don't just have the ones that don't leading the way and being the icon, you know, for success.
Well, right. And I think, you know, I was talking to somebody about this either yesterday or today, earlier, that I think it's really interesting that the 4A's had chosen a woman at the time that they chose me, because of all of the craziness that went on at that moment in time, and then, of course, over the course of the next 9.5 years, I honestly think that a woman, and I don't mean me necessarily, but a woman was better equipped to handle all this than a man would have been.
Yeah, you know, I think, you know, agencies also, I know you took on, there were a couple of agencies that had sexism.
I did.
You know, and, you know, not to mention names, I mean, it's been all over the press, but there have been a couple of agencies that are, you know, well known for having sexist leaders, and it became issues, and you went bold right at it, you know.
Last year at this conference.
And that was brave, I mean, and you really took it on the main stage.
I did, and I remember, actually more so in my calling out of Maurice later that morning than in my speech itself. Because in my speech itself, what I talked about in general was, if you're the CEO of an agency, you are automatically the chief diversity officer. I don't care who else has that title. You are the chief diversity officer. It has to start at the top, because if there's no commitment at the top, it doesn't happen. But then later on that morning, and Shelley will probably remember this, because what had happened was there was a very large public lawsuit that had been filed the week before our conference. And so at the conference, Ad Age, which is this big, had the alleged perpetrator, his picture was this big on everybody's seat. So I couldn't not talk about it. It was like,
ouch.
Okay, you're all sitting on his face. And so I got up and gave a pretty heartfelt speech. I'm now being known for crying on stage. But I gave a pretty heartfelt speech about how I felt about what was going on in the industry with regard to sexism. So a little bit later that morning, Maurice Levy, the head of Publicis, was being interviewed, and he talked about that particular lawsuit not happening in his company, but he talked about it and said, I think it's just an isolated incident. So then I had to get back up on stage with Wendy Clark and have a Q&A with her. And I started the Q&A by saying, Maurice, I hate to tell you, or I beg to differ. I want to tell you that all of the women in this audience would beg to differ with you that that is not an isolated incident. This is the guy who's the head of a major holding company. They pay us a lot of money. And I was very nervous about saying that. And afterward, I ran into one of his CEOs and I said, am I in trouble? And she said, no, you were absolutely right to call him out. And she said, but the hard part is somebody wasn't coaching him because he actually reports to a chairman of a board who's a woman. Yeah. So it's not as if he's not well aware of all of this. He, you know, foot in mouth. But then later on that afternoon, Martin Sorrell took advantage of the whole situation and he had to make a comment about it. Then the two of them got in a pissing match in the press. And I
see there's gossip in our industry too.
Well, it wasn't exactly gossip because it was right there. Yeah. But then I just decided that I was going to continue my drumbeat and do what I do and let them, you know, be men. But it was one of those. And then we also were very fortunate because Shelley was here and she had Madonna Badger here. We had a last minute dropout of a major brand literally the night before. And the first thing that we all said was, let's get Shelley, let's get Madonna, let's do this and put it right on the stage. And we did. And we put it on the main stage.
Yeah, it was amazing. And it was a real visible. It's about visibility. And action. And I think what happened as a result of that, by the way, is now more accountability, like you said, within organizations. You know, when we have a leader that isn't, you know, the right inclusive kind of leader, you gotta, you know, take them out.
Yep.
And I think that, you know, creating that accountability around it. You know, listen, we all have problems, but it's now being conscious of them.
Yeah. And it happens
and doing
now like
something.
This.
Yeah. And so I think that was a really positive, you know, next step is got the problem. We're now making you consciously aware that it is not okay.
Yep.
Do something and create accountability so it doesn't happen again.
That's
make
exactly
a new mistake,
right,
but not that same one. You know, once okay, two times shame on you, right?
Right. I mean, now, you know, the unfortunate part is that that lawsuit is ongoing and why it hasn't been settled, I can't speak to. It's none of my business, but, you know, it's still kind of lingering out there. And I think as long as it's lingering out there, it's not good for anybody. So,
yeah. So, I mean, we just talked about your legacy and the things that you really started vocalizing and not hiding, but, you know, sharing visibly. And Marla Kaplowitz, who's now going to be, you know, your
successor.
I was like, you're the predecessor.
Yes, I'm now the predecessor.
Yes, is going to absolutely take to that next level. I think that that's really an important priority
yep.
for her. So you set that path for her, which it always takes a leader to set that path and really continue on our journey because it is not a point in time
right.
that begins and ends. This is an ongoing journey for all of us collectively. Let's talk about things you're disappointed in. Tell me things that you feel you wanted to push through and you didn't. Do you have any of those stories?
Well,
I mean,
yeah,
we talk
of course.
A lot, and I'm asking you this question for a reason. Oftentimes we think failure is a problem, and I say failure means you tried something new, which is bold and brave, but not everything works. And I share my failures all the time because I think this is how we learn and how we grow.
You know, I think one of the things that I never use the word regret, so I won't use that word, but one of the things that I failed to accomplish before I'm heading out the door is to actually get those numbers that I was talking about. We have tried up, down, left, and right, and there are many people in the agencies who want to give us those numbers, but the lawyers won't let them. And it's an unfortunate byproduct of our industry that there's a fear of lawsuits. And
public companies have to deliver that. So
no, it's not the numbers we want.
Oh.
The numbers that they deliver to the EEOC are not the same as what we want because those are too broad. They're still too broad. They don't really give you the real picture. I want to know how many creative directors they are. Does everybody realize that that 3% number is a made up number? Kat will tell you this. She made that number
Kat, up. 3% conference.
And the way they went about doing that was they went through all of the advertising award shows and all the annuals And they counted, hand counted, the number of women who were listed as a creative director. Now, they're going by names. What if the person's name is Sean? Could be a man, could be a woman. So that number is not necessarily accurate. Mm. And even the growth to 11% was done the same way because there is no number. It's not out there.
Yeah.
And the way they report to the EEOC as a public company is how many there are in the creative department, not how many are creative directors. Or they tell you in account management, or so you don't really get the true picture of whether women or anybody of a diverse nature is getting up into the C-level ranks. Now, what I'm encouraged about is if you look at the press over the last 2 years, the number of women who have moved into very senior level creative positions and very senior level or C-level positions in the agencies has probably doubled. I haven't gone and counted it, but I've been keeping a mental tally. And I'm very encouraged by that. But again, I want those numbers because you can't measure something that you don't have a benchmark for. You of all people know that.
Well, Paul Polman, the CEO of Unilever, says you can't treasure what you can't measure.
Yeah.
And I think that that's really important. And even at the World Economic Forum, they started a new policy because there were so few women. You know, we call our lounge the female quotient, the place for the 18%, because there's only 18% of world leaders are women. And so they started a new policy that, a white badge, which is the main one, you get 4 people to attend as part of the badge, which is historically men.
Right.
And so they said you get a 5th one for free if it's a woman, you know, encouraging companies. And so we were going to change the number to 20%. I was going to put a slash and do 20%. But then when I went and saw it, they were all the plus ones. It was the misses. And I'm like, you can't count that. You know, that's artificial,
exactly.
You know, elevation, which is, you know, what you're talking about. So I think that that's, you know, really important, you know. And I really, you know, I want to get this so that everyone can ask questions. But I really do applaud you for being bold and brave and fearless, because it does take fearless leadership to tackle some of the unspoken, you know, we could call it unconscious bias. I think it's conscious, implicit bias, call it whatever the heck you please. We still have stereotype, you know, and sexist issues, you know, in every industry, not just in the agency business. So what's next for you?
So I thought long, I've planned this for a long time, by the way. When I took this job, I said I would do it for 5 to 7 years, and it's now 9.5. Mm. And so I've been talking about this with the board for 2 years, and now that all of a sudden, January of this year, I was like, oh God, now it's happening, now what do I do? But my husband and I are moving to Cleveland, which
he's amazing, by the way.
Yeah, he is.
A great partner.
Thank you. I'm very lucky, and we knew each other in college, and then we just reconnected 8 years ago, so it's one of those lovely stories.
Aww.
His kids and grandkids are in Cleveland, and my family's in Western PA, so it's an easy drive from there. And my whole criteria for where I went next was close to a major airport, decent cultural scene, lots of colleges and universities, because that's what gives you really good, diverse ways of thinking. And Cleveland fits that for us. So it'll be easy for me to get in and out of Cleveland because I'm going to be consulting, which I have not talked about openly until this conference because I didn't want anybody to think I was trying to solicit business in my current position. I was really careful about that because even people who talked to me about it, I said, I'm not talking to anybody until I'm done. So what I really want to do is work with the independent agencies and work as a coach. More for groups than for individuals, although I'd be open to talking about that as well. Because I want agencies who need somebody to push them. I don't want agencies who are broken and really need somebody to overhaul. I want somebody to come, I want to be able to go in and say, this is all the muscles that you have, and I want to make those muscles stronger.
Amazing. Well, I got to tell you, I think what you've done for all of us in this industry is just, you know, nothing shy of remarkable. And I think you are leaving an amazing legacy. And I know your next chapter is going to create the next new norm, whatever that is. And we are all here, supporting you and especially when you run for office, I'll be your campaign manager. Go, Nancy. Thank you.
Thank
for
you.
Really sharing it.
We love you.